A warm hello to you all. Welcome to my lecture series on mass transfer operations. This is the first lecture in the series. First two lectures will be devoted to introduction to mass transfer operations. We will begin with understanding a typical chemical process. As you know, chemical engineering deals with design of chemical plants, and these chemical processes are carried out to convert raw materials into finished products. So inputs to a typical chemical process are raw materials and energy. Then these raw materials and energy will flow through a sequence of unit operations and unit processes before they are converted into final product. Okay, so outputs from a chemical process are the final products and some energy. Even though modern chemical plants are designed to recover most of the energy, some amount of energy will be lost. That is why this is one of the output from a chemical process. Energy is also one of the output from chemical process. So outputs are raw material. Outputs are finished products and energy. We will understand a typical chemical process with the help of the simple schematic diagram. The rectangular box is representing the chemical process. One input is raw materials, the other input is energy. With these two inputs, raw materials are converted into finished products and some amount of energy is lost out of the chemical process. Okay, so this is the simple way of understanding a chemical process. The objective of any chemical process is to convert raw materials into finished products with the help of energy. Okay, then let us understand what are mass transfer operations. To begin with, we should know that majority of unit operations in a chemical process, they are devoted to separating components of either gaseous mixtures or liquid solutions. And some of these separation operations, they are of purely mechanical nature. For example, filtration, in which the suspended solids in a gas or a liquid are filtered out by using a filter media. Then you have screening, where screens of different mesh sizes are used to separate a mixture of solid particles into different fractions. The fractions will be formed based on the sizes of the particles. Then you have an example of sedimentation. Sedimentation is also a separation operation, but it is of purely mechanical nature. What happens in this operation? You have a liquid in which there are suspended solids. Solid particles. The suspended solid particles are allowed to settle under the influence of gravity, and particles with different densities will settle differently, and in this way you'll be able to separate these suspended solids into different fractions. Okay, so all these operations, they are purely mechanical in nature, and they cannot be called as mass transfer operations. Mass transfer operations are those operations in which the composition of the original gas mixture or the original liquid solution gets altered as the components are being separated. So as the components of a gas mixture or a liquid solution are separated in the operation, the composition of this mixture or the solution gets altered. So these separation operations, they are called as mass transfer operations. So mass transfer operations, they involve transfer of components through a homogeneous phase and also across the interface between two immiscible phases. So during this operation, components will be transferring through a single homogeneous phase, then they will be crossing over the interface between two immiscible phases. The transfer occurs under the influence of concentration gradients. The components are getting transferred due to the concentration gradient, and they will be transferring from a place of high concentration to a place of low concentration. Thus, we can say that the driving force for mass transfer is concentration gradient, and mass transfer will always occur from a place of high concentration to a place of low concentration. Then let us understand the importance of mass transfer operations. How important these mass transfer operations are. To begin with, we will say that all mass transfer operations play a vital role in a typical chemical process. Mass transfer operations play a vital role in any chemical process. Their importance of mass transfer operations can be understood from the following points. First thing is, whenever pre-treatment is necessary for raw materials that are going to into a chemical process, pre-treatment is always carried out by using mass transfer operations. So mass transfer operations are essential for pre-treatment of raw materials to a chemical process. Even the final product of a chemical, the final products obtained in a chemical process, they need final separation. And most of the time, mass transfer operation is used for final separation of these products. That is why we are saying that mass transfer operations are essential for final separation of the finished product in a chemical process. Again, major component of the total cost of a chemical process is due to mass transfer operations. If you calculate total cost involved in a chemical process, major component of that total cost is due to mass transfer operations. Then, after having understood the importance of mass transfer operations, let us classify the mass transfer operations. Let us learn how mass transfer operations can be classified. So, they can be classified in the following way. First is, you have those mass transfer operations which involve contact of two immiscible phases. Then you have those mass transfer operations which involve contact of two miscible phases. Then you have those mass transfer operations where two miscible phases are separated by a membrane. These operations, they are called as membrane separation operations. So membrane separation operations, this is the third category of mass transfer operations. And finally, the mass transfer operations can also be classified either as direct mass transfer operations or indirect mass transfer operations. So our next task is to discuss all these categories in details. We will begin with understanding mass transfer operations which involve contact of two immiscible phases. To begin with, we will say that majority of mass transfer operations used in chemical industries fall in this category. Majority of mass transfer operations involve contact of two immiscible phases. With three states of matter, solid, liquid and gas, there are six possible ways in which these three states can be contacted. So you have gas-gas contact, you have gas-liquid contact, you have gas-solid contact, you have liquid-liquid contact, you have liquid-solid contact, you have, and the last possible type is solid-solid contact. So gas-gas contact, gas liquid contact, gas solid contact, liquid liquid contact, and finally solid solid contact. Sorry. ठीक है. Now, since we know all the gases, they are completely miscible in each other. Therefore, operations involving contact of two gas phases, they are practically not feasible. If you try to bring two gases together, they will completely mix in each other, and the two separate gas phases will not exist as such. That is why operations involving contact of two gas phases, they are not feasible. The other thing is, in case of solid phase, the diffusional rates are very low within a solid phase. The process of diffusion is very slow within a solid phase. Therefore, operations involving contact of two solid phases, they are also very rarely used, or you can say that they are not at all used due to very low diffusional rates within the solid phase. ठीक है. Now let us discuss few operations falling in this category. First, we will start with discussing distillation. Distillation is used to separate components of a liquid solution. When you have a liquid solution in which more than one components are present, one way of separating these components is distillation. So what is done in distillation? A vapor phase is created out of the liquid solution by heating the liquid solution. Once you heat the liquid solution, vapors will be formed. A vapor phase will be created out of this. The newly formed vapor phase, it will contain majority of more volatile components in it, whereas the liquid will be containing less volatile components. So you will be able to separate more volatile components from less volatile components. The vapor phase will contain majority of more volatile components in it. Once the vapor phase is created and the operation continues, the vapor phase is going to remain in contact with the liquid phase, and during this contact, the more volatile components will be getting transferred from the liquid phase to the vapor phase. In other words, vapor phase will be continuously enriched with more volatile component. After sufficient enrichment of vapor phase with more volatile component is achieved, the vapor phase is then condensed to get a liquid phase, which is called as top product or distillate. The top product or distillate will then be containing majority of more volatile component in it, whereas the residual liquid is removed as the bottom product, or it is also called as residue, and it will be containing majority of less volatile component. So we can say that by distillation, we will be able to separate more volatile components from less volatile components that are present in a liquid solution. Then let us understand this operation with the aid of the simplified schematic diagram. So let us say that we have a liquid solution containing two components, A and B. Out of these two components, let us say that A is more volatile and B is less volatile. So let the operation be represented by this rectangular box. So you have the solution of A and B. A is more volatile, whereas B is less volatile. This solution is heated. Energy is supplied to this solution. Once energy is supplied, vapor phase will be created, and vapor phase, more volatile component will be boiling first. That is why the resulting vapor phase will be containing majority of more volatile component in it, and it will also contain little amount of less volatile component. Once sufficient enrichment of vapor phase occurs, what is done? The vapor phase is condensed, heat is removed from it, and it is condensed get a liquid phase that will be containing majority of more volatile component and little amount of less volatile component. As I said earlier, this liquid is called as distillate or the top product. Then the residual liquid, it will be containing majority of less volatile component. It will be containing majority of less volatile component, and it will also contain little amount of more volatile component. So in the end, we are able to separate more volatile component from less volatile component from the liquid solution. Okay. Then the next operation in this category is gas absorption. What is the objective of this gas absorption? Gas absorption is used to recover components, specific components from a mixture of gases. If you want to recover, if you want to remove specific components from a gas mixture, then you can go for gas absorption. Then what is done in this case? The gaseous mixture is contacted with a pure liquid. The gaseous mixture is contacted with a liquid which is almost pure, and this liquid is called as solvent. So in gas absorption, there is a contact of gas phase with the solid phase, and you should note that both the phases are added from outside. Okay. So during the contact of liquid phase and gas phase in the operation, what happens? Specific components from the gas phase, they get dissolved in the liquid phase. Specific, not all components. We are saying that only specific components will be getting transferred from the gas phase to the liquid phase. Then after the components are transferred to the liquid phase, they will form a solution, and you need to recover those components from the solution. And for that purpose, another mass transfer operation is used, and most of the times the mass transfer used is distillation. Okay. So in case of gas absorption, the components that are to be separated, they are present in the solution with the solvent, and they need to be recovered, and for recovering this we need to use another mass transfer operations, and most of the cases the operation is distillation. Again, let us understand this operation with the help of this simplified schematic diagram. Let us say that we have a gaseous mixture. There are two components in it, A and C. A is the carrier gas and C is the solute. Then this gaseous mixture is to be contacted with a liquid solvent. Let us denote that liquid solvent by B. So we are saying that C is soluble in B, but A is almost insoluble in B. So during the contact, out of A and C, only C will be getting dissolved in the solvent. Only C will be getting absorbed in the solvent. A being almost insoluble, very negligible amount of A will be negligible or no A will be going into the liquid phase, going into the liquid solvent. Okay. So you have this operation. You have the gaseous mixture containing A and C. A is the carrier gas, C is the solute. This is contacted with solvent B. So the liquid phase and the gas phase, they will come in contact with each other. During this contact, solute from gas phase, solute C from gas phase will be getting transferred to the liquid phase, and you will have solution of C in the solvent B plus C. C has to be separated by using other mass transfer operations, which most of the times is distillation, and then the gas phase will be kind of coming out, and it will be containing majority of A and little amount of C in it. So this is how gas absorption is carried out, and this is what happens during gas absorption. Then the next operation that we will be discussing is desorption, or it is also called as stripping. What is the objective of this operation? The objective is to recover volatile components from a liquid solution. Stripping or desorption is used to recover volatile components from a liquid solution. So for this, what is done? The liquid solution is contacted with a gas. So stripping involves, or desorption involves, contact of a gas phase with a liquid phase. So during this contact, what happens? The volatile components from the liquid solution, they get vaporized into the gas stream, whereas non-volatile component will remain within the liquid solution. Again, the gas is not soluble in the liquid phase. The gas that is being used to recover the volatile component, that is not soluble in the liquid phase. So let us understand this with the help of the schematic diagram. So you have liquid solution containing A and C. A is not non-volatile or less volatile, or and the component C is volatile. B is inert gas, and other thing is B is not soluble in the liquid. Now these two are contacted. So you have liquid solution A plus C, it is contacted with dry gas B. Liquid solution, liquid phase will come in contact with gas phase. The solute from liquid solution, solute C from liquid solution, will be getting transferred to the gas phase, and then it will come out and it will contain very little amount of C, whereas the gas phase will be coming out with vapors of solute in it. So in this way, we are able to recover volatile component from the liquid solution. Okay. Then the next operation which we will be discussing is humidification. What is the objective of this operation? Humidification is used to increase the vapor contents of a dry inert gas like air. Okay. So for this, what is done? The inert gas is contacted with a liquid, and then liquid will vaporize into the inert gas. The vapors of the liquid will be getting added to the inert gas. In this way, the vapor contents of the inert gas will be increased. The inert gas is contacted with a pure liquid. We have to mention that it is a pure liquid whose vapors are to be added. Then during this contact, the liquid vaporizes into the gas stream. Substance constituting the liquid phase, it is getting transferred in this operation, and the direction of transfer is from liquid phase to the gas phase. So let us understand this operation with the help of this simple schematic diagram. You have liquid A, pure liquid A. This is to be, the vapors of this liquid are to be added to a dry gas B. And the other thing we should note is B is not soluble in A. There is no transfer from gas phase to liquid phase. Okay. So you have liquid A, this is contacted with dry gas B. On this contact, the substance that is constituting the liquid phase, which in this case is A, it will vaporize into the dry gas. Vapors of A will be added to the dry gas and the dry inert gas, and then that dry gas will be getting humidified. Okay, so this is how humidification occurs. Then next operation is dehumidification. Dehumidification, exactly opposite phenomenon occurs, opposite to that of humidification. Okay, so what is the purpose of this operation? It is used to reduce vapor content of a vapor laden gas. If you have sufficient amount of vapors in a dry gas, then you can reduce the vapor content of that dry gas by using dehumidification. Okay. So what is done for that? The vapors present in the vapor laden gas, they are condensed onto a cold surface in order to create a liquid phase. So then the liquid phase will remain in contact with the gas phase, and the vapors will be continuously condensing, and getting added to the liquid phase. So again, the substance constituting the liquid phase is getting transferred from gas phase to the liquid phase. So let us understand this with our schematic diagram. So you have liquid A, pure liquid A. What I mean to say is A is the substance that is constituting the liquid phase. Then you have the dry gas B. Then again, we know that B is not soluble in A. So you have a mixture of dry gas B and vapors of A. This is contacted with a cold surface. So upon this contact, what will happen? Vapors of A will be getting condensed and a liquid layer will be created on the surface of the cold surface that will result in the formation of liquid phase. So as more and more vapors get condensed, the vapor content of the gas gets reduced. So this is all about dehumidification. Now the next operation that we will be discussing is drying. What is the objective of drying? The objective is to reduce moisture content of a wet solid. Drying is used to reduce moisture content of a wet solid. In other words, you can say that drying is used to dry wet solids. So drying of wet clothes is day-to-day example of this operation. So for this, what is done? The wet solid is contacted with a stream of hot and dry gas. Once this contact is made, what will happen? The moisture that is present in the wet solid, it will be getting evaporated into the stream of hot gas, and then the stream of hot gas, which is continuously moving over the surface of the solid, it will be carrying away with it the evaporated moisture. So at the end, you'll be able to reduce the moisture content from one level to the other level. You'll be able to dry the solid. So this involves a contact of a gas phase with a solid phase. So moisture content of the solid is reduced and it gets dried. So you have dry solid, let us represent it by B. Then you have liquid A, which is wetting the solid. B is wetted by A. So you have a dry solid, which is wetted by liquid A. Then this is contacted with a stream of hot and dry gas. So the moisture will be getting evaporated. The vapors of A will be getting added to the stream of hot gas, and then it will be removing those vapors, and finally the wet solid will be getting dried. This is drying. Then there is another operation, which is adsorption. Adsorption, it is used to remove undesirable components from mixture of gases or from liquid solutions. Or it is also used to recover valuable components from a mixture of gases or from a liquid solution. Or it is also used to separate components of a mixture of gases or components of a liquid solution. This operation involves contact of solid phase and gas phase, as well as it involves contact of solid phase and liquid phase. So you can have gas solid contact or you can have liquid solid contact. For removing components from a gaseous mixture, you have gas and solid contact. For removing components of a liquid solution, you have liquid solid contact. So the fluid mixture is contacted with a solid phase, which is called as adsorbent. Adsorbent has capacity of specifically concentrating few components from the fluid mixture. Only those solids which have this capability of concentrating some components on its surface, they can be used as adsorbents. So when the two phases are contacted, fluid phase with gas with the solid phase, specific components from the fluid phase will be getting concentrated on the surface of the solid. A few specific components will be getting transferred to the surface of the solid, and in this way you will be able to achieve separation. ठीक है, so let us understand this. So you have either a liquid solution or a gas mixture A plus C, and this is to be contacted with solid adsorbent B. B has capacity of preferentially concentrating C on its surface. It does not have capacity to concentrate A, so it will just separate out only C, and we will have separation of A from C. ठीक है, so A plus C could be a liquid solution or a gas mixture. It is contacted with solid adsorbent. So upon this contact, C will be getting transferred to the solid surface, and you will have layer of C on the solid surface. In this case, C will be called as adsorbent. You'll be learning in details in future. So we'll have layer of C on the surface of the solid, and in this way you can separate A from C using adsorption. Okay, so that was all about adsorption. The next operation that we will be discussing is liquid-liquid extraction. Liquid-liquid extraction, it is used to separate components of a liquid solution. The other two operations used for this purpose we have discussed are distillation and desorption. So you can use liquid-liquid extraction as well for separating components of a liquid solution. So for this, what is done? The liquid solution is contacted with another insoluble liquid phase. Liquid solution is contacted with another immiscible liquid phase. This liquid is called as solvent. Now what happens when they are contacted? Certain components from the liquid solution, they will be getting transferred, they will be getting dissolved in the solvent. Certain components from the liquid solution, they will be getting dissolved in the liquid solution. So you will have a separation where some components are separated from the original liquid solution, but now they are present in the solvent as the solution, and you need to separate it. And in order to separate these components, we need another mass transfer operation, and in most of the cases it is distillation. Okay, so most of the time the operation that is used to recover separated components from the solvent is distillation. Once you are you recover the components from the solvent, the solvent can be reused in the operation. So again, you will be understanding it in details in future. Okay, so let us understand it. You have liquid solution A and C, and this is contacted with solvent B. C is soluble in B. Out of A and C, only C is soluble in B, and A is almost insoluble in B. So B has capacity of dissolving only C in it. So that's in that way it is able to separate A from C. That is originally present in the liquid solution. Okay, so liquid solution of A and C, it is contacted with solvent B. Upon this contact, solute from the solutions will be getting transferred to the solvent, and you will have most of the C that will be removed from the original liquid solution, and we will get a solution of the recovered solute, and from this solution the recovered solute will be separated by using distillation. Okay, so this is how liquid-liquid extraction is carried out. Then the next operation in this category is leaching. What is the objective? The objective of leaching is to separate components of a solid mixture. For this, what is done? The solid mixture, the solid phase containing various components, it is contacted with the liquid phase. The liquid in this case is again called as solvent. During this contact, what happens? Specific components from the solid mixtures, they get dissolved into the solvent, creating a solution. So in this way, components of the original solid mixtures are being separated. However, the separated components, they are now present as solution in the the solvent and they have to be recovered. And for recovering this, we have to use another mass transfer operations, and most of the time this operation is distillation. Most of the time the operation is distillation. Okay. So you have a solid mixture containing insoluble solid B and soluble solute C. B is insoluble solid, C is solute. This is contacted with solvent A. C is soluble in A, but B is not soluble in A. Okay. So you have the solid mixture B and C. Then this is contacted with the liquid solvent. Then most of the C from the solid mixture will be getting dissolved in the liquid, and you will have liquid solution of A and C. And then from this liquid solution, C can be separated by using another mass transfer operations, which most of the times is distillation. Okay. So in this way, we end our discussion on the first category of operations, which is operations involving contact of two immiscible phases. In the second part of this lecture series, I will be discussing those operations which involve contact of two miscible phases. Thank you.